Welcome to On Point. I'm your host, Brenda Traynor. The topic of today's discussion is animal control services. The Monrovia Police Department in September 2007 brought animal control services in-house as a function of the police department activities. Joining me for today's discussion is our first guest, Ernie the dog. Hi, Ernie. How are you? Ernie is actually my dog, and he's going to dramatize for us what happens when a pet gets lost in Monrovia. He'll be meeting Rhonda Reynolds, the new officer of Animal Control Services in Monrovia, and then they'll be visiting the Inland Valley Humane Society, which will provide kenneling services for animals that are lost in Monrovia. And I don't ever want you to be lost, actually, but I'm glad that somebody like Rhonda is going to be taking very good care of you, Ernie. Please join us. Ernie is a happy dog, and like so many other dogs, he is as curious as he is quick. In the blink of an eye, he can run out of an open gate and head off exploring. Once out of his own yard, there are so many places to go. A sniff here, a sniff there, Ernie follows his nose. There's so much to look at, he might just get so distracted that he'll forget to go home. So poor Ernie is lost in Monrovia. Lucky for him, Monrovia's police department has a new animal control division, and Monrovia's new animal control officers are now working to pick up strays and handle a wide range of other animal management issues for the city. And if your dog is as lucky as Ernie, she'll be found and picked up and checked for identification and license tags. Found pets are safely transported back to the Monrovia Police Headquarters. The city has quick and ready access to their maintained database of registration information. Animal control officers will take found pets to the holding kennel behind police headquarters. There, the animals are scanned over their entire body to maybe find an identifying microchip to seek another clue to ownership. Identifying information is recorded so that important information will be readily available for the efforts to connect owners and their pets. And until then, pets like Ernie will wait in their new quarters, tolerating their new neighbors. But the police department can only house pets temporarily in Monrovia, and lost or unclaimed animals are transported to the Inland Valley Humane Society for sheltering. And that's where Ernie is now headed. We'll catch up with him there later on. So right now, let's learn more about Monrovia's new animal control services. Welcome back to On Point. I'm Brenda Traynor, your host, and the topic of today's discussion is the animal control services that the Monrovia Police Department has now brought in-house. And joining me for today's discussion is Councilmember Dan Kirby.
Thank you. Nice to be here, Brenda.
We're so glad that you are. Officer Rhonda Reynolds, who's the new animal control officer, and Captain Rick Melia, who's been involved with animal issues in the police department for a long time. Right, Rick?
Yes, I have, and enjoyed it all.
That's right. Rick, you had one of the first police dogs in the police department, right?
Yes, I did, back in 1983. Yes. Best memories of my career so far.
Oh, that's great. Well, it's certainly a great asset. I know that you have been very integral in working on this project and bringing it back into the police department. Tell us a little bit about what Animal Control Services does and why we brought it back into become an ongoing service in the police department.
Well, for many years now, we've been contracting our animal services to outside agencies, and they provide response to calls for service, animal licensing, patrol services, and then also assist us in dealing with the wildlife issues in town as we interface with the foothills here in town. So for many years, it's been very cost effective to contract that service out. However, recently, there's been some significant price increases, and that afforded us the opportunity to re-examine things and look at other ways that we might provide this service. And in doing that, we concluded that we could probably provide our services in-house with our own officers, animal control officers, at least the same price or maybe even a savings.
And as a policy issue, animal control is probably one of the most, you know, emotional things that you'll hear from constituents. People get very upset about their pets and want to make sure the pets are well taken care of.
Yeah, Brenda, people love their pets. I mean, that's just part of humanity and life, and many, many of us have pets we love dearly, and it means a lot to us. This was not a decision that we as policymakers came to easily, because we realized that service at this level was not something that we took lightly. When we looked at the financial analyses that came our way when we were faced with this decision, we didn't look at the finances as the first priority. We looked at it to say, can Monrovia provide the same level or better level of service to our residents at the same or better price? And Rick and I discussed this at length many, many times. And Rick and I spent a lot of time discussing it, and we came to the conclusion that we are now in a position with the level of customer service we're offering in many, many other departments that this would be a good move for us. And so we began doing research, finding out what it would cost and if that was indeed the case. That wasn't just a perception. Well, we've come to the conclusion that it is going to be a very, very popular thing for our residents. And Rick can tell you how it's gone so far. I'm thrilled that we have with us our first animal control officer full-time, and Rhonda's here with us, and she can tell you more about the things she's been doing. But so far, things are going very, very well.
And so I'll take that as a great lead-in, Rhonda. Tell us about why you became an animal control officer.
I became an animal control officer because I enjoyed, I've always enjoyed being around animals and working with them. I've done it for the last 20 years, actually. So not necessarily all in animal control, but about 15 years. And then the other four in veterinary medicine. And it's something I just enjoy, you know, those that are sick or injured, helping them. The little babies, you know, and getting them ready for adoption, that sort of thing. I just and protecting them, you know, too, from people who don't take care of them well, and also protecting people from the ones who have never had owners that have socialized them well, and they get out and cause, you know, a public hazard. So you got to look at both ends of it, not just the animal, but you got to protect the people too.
And I've loved being in Monrovia because there is such a sense of caring. I've been mm-hmm. downtown where a giant, it was actually an Irish wolfhound or something, it was a huge animal, mm-hmm. just came walking up and stood next to me. Mm-hmm. And it had run away from home, and it was very happy to be, but I couldn't dare to let it go walking around into the street because it probably would have hurt the car more than the car would have hurt it. And I walked to the police department into the lobby, and they managed to look up its tag, and the person wasn't home with phone number mm-hmm. wasn't home, right. But they actually could go into the database and manage to get another number for that resident and call the resident and had him come and pick it up. And that's even before we had animal control services mm-hmm. within the city. It's part of what Monrovia is that it is a caring community, it's a supportive community, and we get that from our city agencies. Mm-hmm. But I think even more importantly with our animals, sharing some of that control and taking advantage of those resources, the database particularly. Walk me through what happens when you find a lost pet, a dog or a cat here in town.
Well, we in California, you're required by law to scan everything for microchip. If it has a city tag on or an ID tag, that's great. You can contact try to contact them with the information on the tag. However, that seems to be not as frequent as we would like it to be. So we scan them for microchip, and actually, you know, they've been doing that for quite a few years now. So we are getting a lot of pets in that are microchipped. People just need to remember to register the chip. We're finding a lot that are microchipped but aren't registered, and it takes a lot to try to track down where it was sold, and sometimes we can still find out who the owner is that way, but it takes a lot longer. But so we'll scan them, see if there's, you know, any information on it, and then they're impounded, and if we can contact the owner, have them come get them, that's, you know, we'd much rather do that than have to take them to the Humane Society, where they'll have to then go to Pomona to pick them up.
And we'll talk a little bit more in detail in a show later on in the program, mm-hmm. the new facility where animals right. will be taken at Pomona. Now, have you had a chance to get out there yet?
I have. I visited.
Tell me your impressions.
Well, I tell you, Rick and I both went out when it was, well, he recommended that I see the facility we were going to contract with for kenneling services, and it's just beautiful. It's very well staffed. The first thing I noticed was the staffing was very, very good, very professional, plenty of people. It's a very well-funded kennel, and it also is very, very clean. They take extreme precautions to keep animals comfortable, cool when it's hot, warm when it's cold. They're clean. They separate the more vicious animals from the less vicious animals. They have those facilities. They have a very, very good veterinary cast there, cast doctors, nurses. They also have a very, very proactive adoption program there. So I took the tour. I was very, very impressed, and I thought this is a perfect match for Monrovia. It's perfect.
Ed, we'll show our viewers a little bit about getting to the facility as well as the kinds of facilities that they have there, and it is a very pleasant place to be. Mm-hmm. I'm surprised you didn't come home with a couple of doggies or kitties. It's always tough to walk away from when you go to the Humane Society. Amongst the many different services, sort of the sequences, the police department now is going to be in charge of registration. Tell me about that process for animal owners at Monrovia.
Yes, that is one of the big components of animal care and control is licensing the animals. And so we were able to obtain a significant database from the previous company or contract company that was doing the licensing. And when we started exploring different software that we would need to track this licensing, we were very fortunate to find out that the records management system that the police department uses currently and has been since 1993 offers a licensing component. And it completely interacts with our existing records management. So it just adds on that licensing component. So we have all the data that's been in our system for all these years that interacts with licensing. So as we enter licensing information, we know we have our current records, whether it be names, addresses, events that have occurred, all kinds of things that we can that trace amongst themselves, and we can have that data available for our use. So we're pretty fortunate to have that, and we were able to just basically turn on that component at a very reasonable price.
I was going to say, that probably saved a lot, as well as training.
The learning curve was very simple because it was in a system that we've been using. So it was just a matter of almost flipping a switch and doing a little bit of adjusting and tweaking to our needs, and we're up and running with licensing.
So we've got licensing, so in theory all of our pets, dogs and cats in town, will ultimately be licensed. That's our goal, of course. And it takes some getting used to, and we're certainly with this program helping people understand that that's something that needs to be happen. If you have a pet in Monrovia, it needs to be, a dog in Monrovia, it needs to be licensed.
Yes.
Tell me too then some of the other projects that you go through to help educate people about the services that you have. I know you've got a school program and other kinds of activities.
Yes, we hope to get out to the schools and provide education at that level. We have obviously the media that we can use for those types of things. And we hope to provide other types of services like low-cost spay and neutering clinics. Mm-hmm. And when we do our licensing push in the summer, we have low-cost rabies vaccinations as well. And so education is the key. When you come across situations involving animals, there's just so many factors involved, whether it be the wild animals that wander in out of the foothills to our domestic pets. you know, education is the key there. It doesn't always have to result in impounding animals or animals becoming injured. It's a matter of educating to find out what's attracting, if the bear are coming into the area, or if it's a skunk or whatever it might be, what's attracting the animals? It's always, you know, it's not always the animal's fault, and actually very rarely is it. And so if we can educate.
If you leave open the containers of dog food in your backyard, chances are you're going to have skunk.
Yes.
Yes, you will. And we've already seen that if we can go out and spend time with people and look at, you know, survey the situation, survey their property, see what it is that they have that's attracting them, that usually can solve the problem pretty quickly.
You know, and that's also why it's so valuable to have our own in-house, full-time animal control officer. We can respond quickly. Whereas we'd have to wait before with a more, when we...
A regional agency.
Yeah. Now, one call and we've got a person on it. And that, to me, is so valuable because so many people want to know that they're being responded to. And our goal in Monrovia is to respond with an A-plus average. And I think our staff has gone out of its way and worked very, very hard to provide the best possible service in many, many, many aspects of this city. And I'm proud to say that so far this aspect is being done just as well. And I'm just thrilled that we were able to find a very talented and willing animal control officer to come. And we also have a new truck coming, right, Rick?
Yes. And hopefully today as we speak it's being delivered. So we've got some good equipment for the officers to work with, and we're still recruiting our second animal control officer to work with Rhonda, and we'll be able to provide that service. But having our own officers is very important because when you contract and the officers are serving several cities, it's hard to tailor your service just for one particular city. And we can do that now. They're here in Monrovia all the time. They learn the area, they learn the people, and they learn the type of customer service that we provide our citizens. And so it's custom.
And it's custom, and you've made some adjustments even within the facility at the police department to help accommodate these pets. Tell us a little bit about what happened over there for when you bring in a pet.
Yes. Well, when we pick up animals that maybe stray or they're brought to our facility, we like to keep them for a certain amount of time so we can try to identify them, contact the owners, and make it easy for them to come and reclaim their pets. So there may be times that we could keep a dog or a cat at our facility for anywhere from an hour to maybe 8 to 10, 12 hours. And so we have to have a place to put them. So we put together some temporary kennels at the police department in the back parking lot, and we provided shade and comfort and covers and different types of kennels and cages for cats and dogs and different sizes and such. So we have a comfortable, safe, clean environment for them. We don't keep them very long, but it's nice that we can keep them for a few hours until we can either identify them or maybe their owners may be away at work. When they come home from work, they can come to the police station here in Monrovia and get it. And obviously, it's not a type of facility where we would keep animals long term, so if we can't locate the owners quickly, then we'll bring them to Inland Valley, where they can be housed there for longer periods of time until they're located or the owners come to get them.
Well, how would you recommend, if someone comes home and their pet is missing, what would you recommend to them to do, Rhonda? Do they call you first or to call the police department first?
Yeah, they call the police department first because I'm not at my desk 24/7. Sometimes I'm there, often I'm out in the truck. So they want to actually talk to somebody and put in a lost report, just call the police department, and we have both a lost book and a found book, so we can document what is missing, where it's missing from, and then the staff can look up, you know, what has been found, and does it match with what they have lost, and where is it, because at that time, because it'll say if it went to Inland Valley, if it's in the kennel, it'll say it's in her kennel. You know, even some of them end up, you know, hit by car, and that's in there also. We keep everything in there because people want to know. They don't want to just think, oh, it just ran off somewhere. They want to know either way. And so we document everything, and 9 times out of 10, if it's in there, you know, it's they can come right down and get it.
They can come and get it.
Yeah, so.
And if that is not successful, then the animal is transported to Inland Valley mm-hmm. Humane Society
right.
in Pomona,
right.
which I know there was a little bit of criticism about that, but now mm-hmm. I've driven the route. It is mm-hmm. actually a pretty easy facility
right.
to find.
Mm-hmm.
Have you heard, or are people happy with this arrangement?
You know, I haven't heard not one complaint. It is a little further, but because of the freeway system, you get there probably faster than you would have at the previous facility. But I've heard no complaints to me about it. But I think those people who would wish to visit, I think they'd love to give you a tour. I think that they're proud of their facility. They should be. It's beautiful.
Yeah.
And I'm very happy we were able to contract with Inland for those services. I'm very pleased.
And in addition to dealing with lost pets that really should have a home, I'm understanding too that we've got quite an uptick in the number of feral animals that are being turned in. Talk to me a little bit about that. Primarily cats, right?
Yes, the feral cats are, you know, they're basically domestic cats that have never been handled by humans. And some people will dump them as kittens. We find them in boxes. Some people don't realize that that's the best time to actually turn them in before they get old enough to procreate. So they go out, and it's amazing how quickly they can overpopulate. It doesn't take mm-hmm. them very long, and you know, 2 litters a year. You know, you just can't let them go like that. So they, you know, we're picking them up. We have traps to loan out to people. They can come in and get one, and we'll pick up however many feral cats they catch.
And when you say traps, too, mm-hmm. explain
they're
that they're humane
yeah,
traps.
They're humane yeah. traps. Yeah, you just bait them, and they close behind the cat when it goes in for the food, steps on a plate, it shuts behind them, doesn't hurt them. And we'll come and pick them up and, you know, take them to humane. Sometimes you do have people that have cats that are actually, you know, they're kind of fractious even with the owner, but they're owned.
Yeah.
You know, I own one of them.
the fractious
you know,
cat.
Yeah, he just isn't a very friendly cat, and, you know, just some are that way. But, you know, if he was gone, I would be in pursuit of wherever he had gone, you know, because he's still my cat.
And the same record keeping then applies. If
mm-hmm.
you take in
yep.
feral
Doesn't
kittens,
matter.
You know, a whole
yep.
litter full of kittens, you'll have records of those.
Yeah.
In
yeah.
case it was someone's.
Yes, they're all documented. Because
yeah.
you never know. They can
sometimes
be scared.
A pregnant cat will run off to have its kittens and
right.
will run away from home.
Well,
so.
And sometimes cats, you know, you can have a perfectly calm cat at home and it gets stuck in a trap and it's freaked out because it's not used to being in that confined of a space. And they may act like they're feral. And, you know, you give them a day to cool down and all of a sudden you find out they're nice.
Yeah.
You know, so you never 100% sure. So.
Well, I'm very happy that you're on board, and Rick, that this program seems to have taken off with a great launch.
Yes.
And very good services, and I certainly hope that you, council member, are going to continue to hear no complaints about this new program.
Well, you'll never hear no complaints, but hopefully we can just provide the level of service that we're accustomed to here in Monrovia, and it is our goal to be 100% satisfactory with any issues dealing with your animals and our animals, because they mean a great deal to us, and we do not take any of this lightly at all. This is a very, very important program, and I'm pleased to say that it's gotten off to a great start.
I think it has, and I'm very anxious for you, our viewers, to see what the new Inland Valley Humane Society looks like as we continue the journey of Ernie, the lost dog in Monrovia. Please stay tuned. Ernie is dramatizing what it's like to be a lost dog in Monrovia. In this case, Animal Control Officer Rhonda Reynolds was unable to reunite him with his guardians in Monrovia, so he's been transported to Pomona, to the Inland Valley Humane Society, where Ernie can be sheltered. Here, Ernie is meeting the staff to demonstrate how the intake evaluation is conducted. Animals are assessed by the Inland Valley staff veterinarians in their medical facility. It includes a surgical theater where sick or injured animals can be effectively treated. But Ernie is just getting a good checkup to keep in his file. Inland Valley Humane Society is a full access shelter, meaning that they accept lost, homeless, injured, and abandoned animals. While the staff will continue the search for the match of pets and people, if it's unsuccessful, an animal will be considered to be put up for adoption. While the Inland Valley Humane Society is now Monrovia's shelter facility for lost pets, it's also an ideal place to find a pet you might want to adopt. Behaviorists at the shelter evaluate these animals to assess their temperament with a series of tests to see how they will react to being handled or played with, assessing their dominance and aggressive tendencies. This hand-on-the-stick is a risk-free test to see how a dog will react at mealtime, a time when aggression is most often shown. But as you can see here, Ernie is pretty mellow and would be considered a highly adoptable dog. Lucky for us, this is only a dramatization, and he'll be going back home with me to Monrovia. I'm here at the Inland Valley Humane Society. This is the new home away from home for animals that will be picked up by Monrovia's animal control officers. I'm here with Bill Harford, who's the executive director of the society.
Well, we're very excited to be able to provide the sheltering services for the city of Monrovia. The Inland Valley Humane Society has been at this location at Humane Way for 57 years now, and we have quite a few partnerships in the community. Monrovia is our newest member of our network, and we're able to provide, we think, outstanding sheltering services for those animals that are in need of a home away from home. We're here to provide adoption services, redemption services, interface with Monrovia's animal control officers, interface with the community to try to provide all the services they need of a shelter, of a contemporary modern shelter. The facility that you'll see today is kind of an interesting one. You've come at a time when we're in the middle of a $1.8 million renovation. First phase is done in our adoption ward, and we're working on our stray ward. The facility has definitely seen a lot of changes over the last 57 years, and over the next year, we'll see a lot of changes also.
Tell me a little bit about the background of this society and how long you've been here.
I've been here for 29 years as the executive director. I came here when I was 12. The Inland Valley Humane Society was formed by four women of Pomona in 1949 who were very concerned about how animals were being treated by the city of Pomona. The city had a shelter that just didn't set up to the standards of animal care, and those four women started the Humane Society of Pomona Valley, which is now the Inland Valley Humane Society and SPCA. We service a very large area of the Inland Valley, and we're very, very proud of our facility, which you'll get a tour of today. We're very proud of the 65 people that come here and care for these animals every day. You'll get to meet our veterinarian, our behaviorist, our adoption coordinator, all the people that the City of Monrovia residents will get to meet in their visit to our organization. And we're going to kind of walk you through how what will happen when an animal comes into our facility, and hopefully all the people from Monrovia will come and retrieve their animals that have broken out of their fences, jumped the fence, whatever caused their animal to end up in the arms of animal control to be brought here to our facility. We want them to all come here and claim their animal. And those people who are looking for a new companion for life, we would love to provide them with a great, fluffy animal to take back home with them. Our board of directors this year asked for a new architecture firm to come in and look at our facility and bring it up to contemporary standards. The society, as I said, was formed in 1949. It was first building on this site was built in 1950. And from that time to present, there are about 11 different additions that have been made to this facility. The board of directors, from what they got back from the architect and the design people, agreed on a $1.8 million renovation that's going to take place over the next 12 months. We've already completed our adoption ward, which was donor dollars for about $250,000. We'll be doing a capital campaign. Our city, our network cities, our contract cities, activities will be involved in this process. But you're going to see a facility that's really taking some giant steps in the right direction. Not that it wasn't a good facility before, but you know, when you build a building in 1950 and now it's 2007, leaning on eight quickly, there's a lot of things that you can do to make it better for the animals. You know, for example, all of the kennels in our facility are heated floors. Even though this is Southern California, and I grew up in Maine, where you know our dogs were happy to be able to come in the barn at night. All of our facilities are heated floors. You'll see that the animals are in great shape. We have two veterinarians on our staff, one presently, one off of maternity leave. Four registered veterinary technicians. These are young people who have graduated from Cal Poly Pomona and four-year degrees in veterinary technology, and some Mount SAC students who have graduated with two-year degrees. We have a great staff. 65 people come here every day who care about animals. We have 125 active volunteers that do socializing, and we'd invite Monrovia residents to come and sign up for our volunteer programs. It's a very, very active organization and a very nice facility, and Monrovia is going to get the best of all of it, because by the time we finish this first year, they're going to have a completely brand new facility. I mean, everything, as you'll see, is being retrofitted to contemporary standards, new lighting systems, new fans. Everything is just absolutely gorgeous.
Well, I can't wait to see it. Let's go take a look.
Sounds good. Every animal that comes into the Inland Valley Humane Society goes through a process of intake. We want to make sure that the animal has been checked out by the animal control officer, the humane officer, or our kennel attendants. We want to make sure that the animal has an identification. The identification that's put around the animal's neck is there so in case a like animal is in a cage with them. And by the way, we do kennel animals, dogs, by sex and size. So in the case of this animal, it'll go into a kennel with other animals of its same size and same sex, and they're pack animals, and they like to play with each other, and they will growl a little bit at each other, but we monitor their activities. We want to make sure that the animal has been fed and watered, so you'll see that every cage has that available to them. The intake process is extremely important to make sure that we have proper breed, sex, aging, everything is down on the paperwork, so that if anyone calls into the shelter, comes to the shelter to look for their animal, we have all the pertinent data for that animal. This is our pet receiving area. This is the intake area when animals come into the shelter, either from the public or when our officers bring them in. The animals are intaked here. This animal here is a cat that will determine if it's feral or not. In the case of the dog that comes in, we will check it for a microchip. This is a scanning device, and the animal will determine whether or not it has a microchip. We want it over the nape of the neck to determine whether or not it has a microchip. If it's been microchipped, it'll come up with an ID number. We'll call in that ID number to determine who the owner of that is. So every animal that comes into the facility is scanned. By the way, in Monrovia, they have these in their vehicles, and they will scan for microchipping when they rescue the animal off the street. So every animal, after it's been scanned, will put a tag on it. This is an identification that we use in the shelter to identify the animal, so that when that animal goes into the kennel, it will go in by size, it'll go in by sex, and there may be a like animal in that kennel with it, and they love to be in kennels with more than one animal, and some people say, well, that you put in too many animals in the cage. These are pack animals. They like to play with each other, they're comforting, they like that attention. They're very social creatures, so it's very important to put them in kennels with other animals. They'll get very depressed coming off the street if you don't have somebody for them to talk to and play with. This will be their identification, and then we'll place them in the cage. Let's go into one of the kennels. Hi, guys. These are our it's a little noisy in here, so bear with us. These are our kennels. All the animals are as comfortable as possible. As you can see, all the floors are heated, stainless steel water bowls. They have water 24 hours a day. We hand feed every animal every day. We have yappers. When our veterinarian comes into these kennels, every animal will be examined to make sure of the health of every animal. Our animal behaviorist will check animals for temperament. Every animal that is kenneled, the
Any problems with that animal, any health problems, behavior issues are brought to the attention of our veterinarian staff or to our behaviorist. When the veterinarian walks through the kennels, she's looking for upper respiratory problems. She's looking at fecal material and urine to determine whether or not the animal has any problems. Of course, most of the animals that come into an animal shelter, we have no past history on them, so we have to very quickly assess every animal to determine its health. It's very important that if we have an animal that's sick, that it's brought out of the kennel and put into our isolation area back next to our veterinary office. The veterinarians every day are going through the facility checking on every animal. We really depend on our kennel staff to bring to the attention of our veterinarians any problems that they see. Of course, they're feeding and cleaning and feeding and cleaning and cleaning and feeding all day long. So they're interfacing with the animals and they can bring any problems to the attention of the veterinarian. Our behaviorist, when she's coming through, she's checking for temperament. It should be pointed out, one of the really, really important issues at our organization is that we are a full access shelter. We don't turn any strays or homeless away. So that means that we have to assess every animal because not every animal is going to be adopted or returned to its owner. And that means that there is going to be humane euthanasia. But we want to make sure that when we finally make a decision on an animal, which could be anywhere from 2 weeks to 2 months, that that animal has been assessed properly. We want to make sure the veterinarian has seen it, we want to make sure the behaviorist has seen it, and we want to make sure our adoption coordinator has looked at the animal to determine its adoptability. But euthanasia is something that we don't take lightly. It's our responsibility to assess every animal and make sure that every animal that comes into this shelter is given an opportunity to be rehomed. So when our behaviorist is going through, it's very important for her to do that temperament assessment. When the veterinarian goes through, and our veterinarian has been with us for almost 8 years, she loves what she does, and this is where she wants to be, and these animals are her babies, and she wants to make sure that she assesses their health, and if these animals need to be taken into vet services for anything, we provide it. We're very fortunate to have clients like Monrovia who are paying the health bills for these animals. And we're very proud of what we do at this facility, and we invite anybody from the city of Monrovia to come here and adopt an animal from us. As I mentioned, we're in the middle of a $1.8 million renovation here at the Inland Valley Humane Society. Behind me is the adoption ward that has just been completed, and next on the horizon is our stray ward. If you look at some of the systems that are being redesigned, the whole filtration system in the kennel is being redone. All the locks and all the chains are going to be gone. New locks have been placed on the cages. Much more friendly and a much healthier environment for the animals. You know, we're looking at a facility that was built in 1950. Well, the technology that we have, all the information we have about animal shelters today is all being put into this process of this renovation of this facility. So this is going to be a great facility for the animals. It's going to be a great facility for our care attendants to be able to maintain a healthy environment for all the animals. And I think as residents of Monrovia come to this facility, they're going to be really excited about the city of Monrovia having their animals come to a very, very modern, up-to-date, contemporary facility. Animals that are coming in from Monrovia that have been hit by a car or sick or have other injuries would come here to the Inland Valley Humane Society and SPCA's Medical Center. That's during the day. After hours, if an animal control officer picks up an injured or sick animal, they'll go to the emergency clinic closest to Monrovia. But during the day, the officer would bring them here. Robin Ceballos is our veterinarian. She does all the rounds that you saw. She also takes care of any of the in-house injuries, anything that's coming off the street. So it's very demanding of her to take care of these animals. But we're giving them all the medical attention that they need. There are mandatory holding periods, and it's very important that we make sure that these animals are comfortable during the time that they're here while we're searching for their owner or determining whether or not the injury is severe enough that it may have to be humanely euthanized or the injury is recoverable so that we can place that animal up for adoption. But we're very fortunate here at Inland Valley to have that veterinarian, another veterinarian slot, and also four registered veterinary technicians, along with vet assistants. And we have two workability programs, one with Mount San Antonio College and one with Cal Poly Pomona. So we have students coming through our facility, training all the time. We have a lot of caring eyes looking after the animals coming in from Monrovia. What a lot of people don't realize is that animal shelters across America are now handling more cats than they are dogs. And I think Monrovia, in the very short time that they have been bringing animals to the Inland Valley Humane Society, have found that out, that we are seeing a lot of cats coming in from Monrovia. You know, the bottom line with the pet overpopulation problem is spay and neuter. It's very important for people to accept that responsibility. And these kitty cats are cute, but they grow up to be cats, and they grow up to have more cats. And the Inland Valley Humane Society last year handled over 15,000 stray and homeless animals here at our facility. Believe it or not, of that 15,000, 10,000 were cats. So those numbers are very important, and we hope that the people of Monrovia take it to heart, that have a heart and spay and neuter your pet. Monrovia residents who have lost their pet and need to come to the facility, this is where you would come, to our front office. We're open Monday through Saturday from 8 in the morning until 5:30 in the afternoon. On Wednesdays, we're open until 7 o'clock at night. And our kennels open at 10 o'clock every day, Monday through Saturday. Redemptions are, you can do those after 10 o'clock. If you're going to process any other business, it would be before the 10 o'clock hour. Let's go into the office and see what's going on.
Perfect.
So coming into the front office, our customer service people will get all the pertinent information, show proof that you own the animal. If you leave home without proof, we're going to send you back to Monrovia. So what you want to do is bring a picture, bring your current license, whatever will show proof that is your pet. And then you come into our front office, we'll take care of all the paperwork, and we'll retrieve your animal for you, and off you go back to home. There is a redemption fee. Those are set by the city of Monrovia. There's a food and care charge. There is a spay and neuter charge. But those fees are minimal compared to a replacement cost.
I've got my little buddy here, and I've made a great commitment to him, and as he has to us, in making our home a very happy place. For Monrovians, the Inland Valley Humane Society is the new place to go, either to bring your dog home if it's run away, or to go through your own adoption process and add a new member to your family. Bill, tell us what that process is.
Well, it's very important that everybody finds an animal that works for their lifestyle. Well, as you can see, you have your somebody with Ernie, and thank you for bringing Ernie and sharing him with us today. So we've developed a program called Find Your Somebody. There's a small application process to make sure that everybody's on the same page of other animals in the home that we make sure they're compatible. Young children, make sure that they're compatible. So we go through this process, and it is a process because today you're adopting an animal for life. And animals, the one we have in our facility under our licensing program, we have one that's been with us for 22 years that we've licensed in the city of Pomona. So you're making a commitment to this animal to be your somebody. And so you fill out the application. We guarantee the adoption, the health of the animal. We're kind of the Nordstroms of adoption. We give you a 2-week aftercare. A lot of the animals that come in, like going to kindergarten, have an upper respiratory. It's mild. We put them on antibiotics. Again, Dr. Ceballos that you met earlier in the show, she takes care of all those aftercares. Our adoption rate is about 65% of the adoptable animals are going to new homes. We invite Monrovians to come over and choose an animal at our site. There's always somebody waiting to go home.
I want to thank very much Bill Harford for giving us this great tour today and showing us a lot about what's going on at the Inland Valley Humane Society, Monrovia's new animal shelter.